So good morning, and so of course I want to thank Edith and Hug for this invitation. I'm very happy and I would say very, in fact, excited to be here. So as said, Edith, I'm basically a molecular biologist, and that started recently in my team something more related to ecological situations, of course, to answer some basic biological questions. So that means that what I will present today is a little bit away from my comfort zone, I would say, as a detailed molecular biologist. But so I'm very excited to present that in this situation, in this context. I'm also very happy, but it's more for personal reasons, since my PhD mentor at the Pasteur Institute some time ago, Maurice Hofnung, was himself a student of François Jacob. So it's a particular reason why I'm also very happy to be here. So I will ask the same questions. I will not give you some clear answer, maybe other questions, as usual. Studied by two different organisms, I would say. I mean, Saccharomyces cerevisiae and coral, but basically the same telomere or telocentric question as you want. So I think that it's necessary to give you some introductions about telomeres. So telomeres are the end of our chromosomes. So eukaryotes have linear chromosomes, some bacteria, but mostly all eukaryotes and very few bacteria. And the fact to have linear chromosomes, it's a problem to maintain the stability of our genetic material. And let's say this is the first, let's say, function of telomeres that has been described and still actively studied. And I would say, so just as a reminder, because it would not be directly used in this talk, but I think it's important for you to know, that there is two types of, let's say, basic molecular problems. At the end, because of this linearity, the fact to be able to fully replicate up to the last nucleotide. And this is not a trivial problem because conventional replication machinery is unable to do it. And this is a job in many cells, not on all, but let's say of a well-known enzyme named telomerase, which is basically a specialized reverse transcriptase. The second problem is the fact that this, let's say, natural chromosome ends, or DNA extremity, has not to be recognized as an accidental double-strand break. Otherwise, this will rise to a very high instability in our karyotype because of recombination event. And this function is provided by a distinct mechanism that is provided by a particular protein that really cap and protects the end of our chromosome. So this is the basic things. And the maintenance things, I would say. So now telomere is what I want to say are many other functions that we are discovering, one after others. And so just as a reminder, so they are also involved in the general nuclear architecture. So this is a yeast nucleus where the telomeres are close to the nuclear periphery, where, in fact, they form some kind of silencing compartment. That means that they have an influence on the gene transcriptions of genes that are close to them, but sometimes to genes that are located more far away from them. So it means that they have an influence on the whole genome transcriptome. I think that's the things to have in mind. And maybe, and this is directly related to what I will tell you today, I like to present it like that. That means they have a very important stress signaling function for two reasons. One reason is that their structure is very sensitive to many different types of stressors, either directly, intrinsically, because of their base composition, but also through physiological mechanism. For example, it's known that stress hormones directly act on the maintenance pathway of telomeres as a direct mechanism, not an indirect or a consequence of other things. That means that I like to say that, like birds somehow, they are some kind of sentinel of our genome. And they integrate this signal and they transmit that to the cell through different ways. The best way is to signal through a particular pathway of DNA damage response that could give rise to cell cycle arrest, or even senescence, or apoptosis. But not only, and as I told you, they can signal also through, let's say, large-scale modification in our genome. So this is very important. It's known in model organism, and in fact, the ecological reasons of this signaling is still very poorly understood. This will be one of the topics of what I'm trying to do now. And this is also important because, of course, this signaling pathway has a physiological, in fact, of course, meaning for us as human, and also with implications for aging and disease. Why? Because, in fact, we are normally programmed to lose our telomere in our somatic cells. And this is programmed through this problem of replication, cell division. So this is really genetically programmed, but also this can be accelerated, as I said, in case of stress. And this determine, in fact, the length of our DNA in somatic cells can determine our way to age and the appearance of many age-related diseases. So I don't go into detail. So I think that you understood that they are very important structure of our genomes. And having that in mind, it's quite surprising that, in fact, if you look in a more, let's say, evolutionary perspective, or phylogenetic perspective, they are quite diverse. They are quite diverse in their structure. And if you look at the space of sequence, of telomeric sequence across taxa, they are quite different and they don't follow the classical phylogenetic relationship. And even within a given species, if you look now at the length can be very variable. So this was a previous study made in nematode C. elegans, where it formed isolate in from the wild. And there is a large variation around a mean, of course, but a large variation between the isolate. And for such a very important structures of genome maintenance and also homeostasis, this is quite surprising, I think, to see this variability. So I think that you can see this natural variability in two ways. One is to say, okay, it's just meaningless variations that occur by chance and with no, let's say, physiological or fitness advantages, or you can see it as some kind of mechanism that somehow improve fitness or adaptation, and that is almost totally unknown. In order to answer this question, that is the key question that we try to understand now, you need, of course, and this is the confluence of molecular biology and ecological preoccupations that was said by, presented by Edith before. You need to be able, in a large corpus of data set, to be able to study relationship between telomere, of course, telomere length, or maybe other telomere parameters, phenotype and environment relationship. So that's the two stories I will present you. The first one, take advantage of the 1,002 Saccharomyces genome collection that, in fact, has been sequenced totally, and the second one is a coral one. So, what is the 1,002 genomes of yeast? This is a work that was led by Jenny Litti, in fact, in the same lab where I am, and with the help of a genoscope also, like Tara Ocean and Tara Pacific. So these are so Saccharomyces cerevisiae can be found as isolate in nature in various different situations. So either in the wild, and in trees or in the soil, but also, as you know, also they have been domesticated and to perform fermentations for wine and also for bread. And also there is some Saccharomyces cerevisiae which are, let's say, somehow related to human activities. I mean, like, for example, the one that are growing on olive trees, for example. So that means that somehow there is some kind of human environment. Also, they are not directly used for their fermentation properties. And some, of course, also colonize our gut and a form of microbiota. And even in some people in New Guinea, in fact, there are some French New Guinea, there are some dominant population of Saccharomyces cerevisiae in their microbiota, which is quite unusual in human microbiota. Anyway, So we took advantage, and this is the work of PhD student Melania and the team. We took advantage of this huge collection of sequences to infer telomere length, not by a direct measurement, by biochemistry, but by designing a small script that allow us to infer, in fact, from the NGS data, the length of the telomere, of the corresponding strain. It's not an easy, it was not an easy task because the sequence of the repeat is irregular in budding yeast, and also because there are some interstitial sequences. Anyway, so Melania succeeded, and I can say that she succeeded because for a subset of strain, when we really measure telomere length, we had a good predictions. We have a good correlation with a predictive size. So we can use this data that have been, again, collected for the 1,000 strains. And this is the result, the global result, so around the world, very mean length. So this is the mean length of the domestic wine, European wine, and you see that around this mean, we have a large distribution. Some yeast are very, very long, and some yeast in a Malaysian strain are very, very short. So we can discuss that if you are interested. But in terms of geography, global geography, in terms of continent, also in terms of ploidy, there is not so much, let's say, I mean, there is no, in fact, correlation that we can make between the length of the yeast telomeres and these parameters. But so we did, you can imagine, extensive correlations. And what we found is the fact that there is a clear, let's say, separations of the regarding telomere length between the yeast that were isolated in the wild and those that are used by us for fermentations. And they are much longer. I mean, the domestic one are much longer as compared to the... So domestic means fermentation. It doesn't mean that they are human-associated. This is another category. So importantly, this was seen both at the level of the clad and at the level of the single strain. Now, of course, the question is whether there is some kind of bias. Now, if you look at the large clad of European wine-making strains, some, in fact, return to the wild. And this was very interesting now to see that when they return to the wild, whether they return to short telomere. And indeed, the few examples of wild strains within the, let's say, domestic clad, as you can see, we maintain, in fact, this difference in telomere length. That means that when this yeast return to nature, let's say, somehow, and they lose the domestication, let's say, context, they return to a short telomere length, which probably, for me, suggests that, in fact, it has some kind of biological meaning. And now the beauty of this system is that we can cross all the data for 50 different phenotypes that have been tested by high throughput technology in laboratory, and this data set exists. And we don't find so much correlation. We did that separately for the domestic and the wild strain. And you see that it was clear that for the wild, but not for the domestic one, we have a correlation between telomere length. Not a huge, but at this level, it's not so bad, with mitochondria, both mitochondrial contents. That means that shorter you are, in fact, and less mitochondrial activity or contents you can observe in the corresponding strain. So this was the first part. So that means that we have a clear relationship. Of course, cause and effect, cause and consequence effect is difficult to decipher from that, but we have some line of research linking telomere, mitochondria, and domestication that was not known before. But we can think about the role of telomere in that. I will come back in my last slide. So the second story, starting from the same question, but now focus on coral. So why to focus on coral? Coral are animals, and they are very interesting for research or adaptations and aging for several reasons. And so this is, again, let's say, the chance we have now to be able to study, let's say, non-model organisms with a tool of molecular biology, as was said before, and I think it's very quite exciting. So why coral? So coral are colonial organisms. I mean, the basic, let's say, structure is a poly, but you can consider the colony as an individu, as a whole. And They are an important aspect of their biology is the fact that the reef coral, it's not true for all coral, but the reef coral, their endothelial cells, in fact, live in a symbiosis with an alga, so it's a mix between animal and plant, if you want, somehow, and that provide most of the carbon source by photosynthesis. And because of this symbiosis, and because, of course, of their living in the sea, they have to face, in fact, daily huge homeostatic breaking in terms of oxidative stress, and because of the symbiosis, because of UV exposure. That means that they have been adapted to that, and strikingly, in face of such a stressful condition, they can live very long. So this is an example of Porites. So you see a diver here. So it's very huge. And when it has been recorded, it has been shown that they can live up to 1,000 years. I mean, some kind of world record for an animal with some clams. And some others are smaller and live less according to the record we have, like the smaller Poecilopora colony that is shown here on Tagoisi. In terms of telomere, it's very nice because they have the same sequence than us. I told you the phylogeny is very bizarre for telomere sometimes. And also, in fact, in the same animals, we have a mix between human type telomere and plant type, and with an additional T, which is enough to design some specific molecular probe that we call T3, which, of course, is the telomere of the symbiont, plus the telomere of all the proteins that could be part of the hologenome of the coral, but we are not studying yet for the moment. So the first question, of course, if you start with a new model, almost nothing is known on coral telomere, is to know about the coral telomere cycle, let's say. So is that like human? When they age, do they shorten their telomere? Of course, is the first question to answer. So we design a strategy. In fact, it's a gold standard method for telomere length measurement. I mean, 1,000 blotting, it works well, and we normalize everything to a human or Arabidopsis telomere in order to have reliable and comparable results when we make large-scale measurement. And this is the work of Alice Rouen, a PhD student in my team. So when we study the telomere length from this short-lived species, Poecilopora, that were collected in Clipperton Island by the Tara boat, and in fact, of different size, and there is no change in telomere length. Now, it's a different experiment. Now, it's another branch coral, a little bit like Poecilopora, it's a different one, Stylophora. Anyway, we use them because they are cultured in tank at the Centre Scientifique of Monaco, close to Nice. And because of that, they can breed in aquarium. And we can have coral now of known age, okay, from fertilization. 1 year, 2 years, 4 years, and those that are present for a long time in tank. And there is no telomere shortening, at least from 1 year to 4 years. And even we have some lengthening of telomere for the very old one. Eventually, we can discuss that. We don't know the reasons, but there are some explanations of that could be interesting to discuss. But the important point is that there is no clear relationship between telomere shortening and age or size of the colony in coral, at least through these two different examples. Now, this allows us, in fact, it was a great opportunity for me to be part of this Tara adventure. So now it's an expedition after the Tara Ocean expedition it's a cruise that was between 2016 and 2018. In fact, the boat came back roughly 1 year ago at Lorient, starting this from Brittany. And the main objective of this expedition, funded by Tara Ocean and many others, of course, organisms and laboratories. It's really, the question is different from Tara Ocean. The question is really, the basic question is really to collect as much as we can about the coral hologenome. And that means the coral of the genome, the coral of the alga, but also all the microbiota of the coral together. I mean, done to cross all this data with environmental data, and in order to see, in fact, the influence of climate change, eventually on the change in microbiota, on the whole genome, but also to see how the whole genome, in fact, could be part of the evolutionary process of coral. And we see in this large, let's say, project, somehow I'm responsible of an ancillary project within that, which is to study telomeres. So since we don't know so much about telomere in coral, we cannot use it really as a marker. So it's more the scientific question, the basis that I'm asking to that. But that we'll be able to cross with all the parameters that are collected. So basically, so it's throughout the Pacific, 32 islands, there are 3 sites which are explored per island, and for each site, 10 coral samples per species are collected. And for each of these samples, it's a little bit like Tara Ocean somehow. We have we have parameters on the coral host. Genomic is also done at the genoscope. Metatranscriptomic, metabarcoding, taxonomic parameters, some biomarkers of oxidation, so I'm measuring telomere length, but we start to have some contextual parameters. I mean, everything that can be measured directly in the boat, but also data that can be extracted from satellite, and also some from huge, for large coral. Some coral core have been samples, and we can now look at more paleo markers, at least a few dozen of years before. So three coral species, a long-lived one, so this is by chance for us, a relatively short-lived one, and a slightly different type of coral named Millepora. So, my students extract more than about half of the samples that were collected. That means 1,363, so she's very proud of that. DNA extraction, 1,000 running, and so these are the global result. So first, there are some kind of species-specific mean telomere length, as expected, so this as expected. And for the animal, for the alga, it's much more diverse, in fact, so that we still don't understand. In fact, we are more focused now on the animal. It's probably easier to interpret for the moment. Also, we have the data for the alga. And the great variation between samples, again, is what I expected. I show you previous results, for example, in wide C. elegans that gave similar results. Now, if you look globally, it's, of course, it's difficult to extract some data. I mean, you have to understand that it's ongoing research. So we don't have the full set of things. I will summarize that at the end. But I show you the results for Poecilopora, but we got the same things for Porites and also somehow for Millepora. In fact, so this is the island. Each bar is an island. And in fact, there is some kind of homogeneity of telomere length per island. So of course, we don't know the reason, so we can discuss these ongoing things. But clearly, there is what we call an island effect, whether it is genetic, environmental, or both. So that's the crossing of all the data will tell us. But clearly, there is such an effect, which is very encouraging for us, of course, because it means that we have something to understand and to study. I'm almost finished. And so it's not the same again for alga, so I pass very rapidly. So now it's where we are. We have a very beautiful coral ecosystem, big data warehouse, let's say. And we are now just at this point where we did our job. We measure telomere length. We wait for many genomic data from the consortium to, of course, to be sure about the taxonomy before to arrive any conclusions. And also all the contextual data. And in order to cross them, I think that next year we will be able to have the taxonomic data on all these samples and to be able to cross them in a robust manner. So just to summarize the main result I show you, we have a collection of 1,000 Saccharomyces cerevisiae. We have a link with domestication, which I think is very important, and we have to think and to imagine about that. The telomere of coral do not seem to have the same cycle fanus, and they don't correlate with age. It's not the only animal like that, but it's one of them. We can eventually comment on that. And we are in the middle of the work with Tara. So I'd like to make some speculation about that, just to tell you why I'm so excited to pursue that and to transfer that into maybe more experimental. I think that, probably from yeast, but from coral, I guess it will be the same, but we will see, is that the surprising thing is that, in fact, short telomere in the wild appears to be beneficial or maybe selected during the evolution of this organism. And we have to think about that because the current view, in fact, in human or in human health studies, is the fact that short telomere and it's known that are very bad, in fact, because they increase your risk to develop disease and to age before, let's say, the normal. And I think that we have to distinguish when you are in a wide environment, or you are, in fact, in limited resource, or you are under chronic stress, or you have to adapt to extreme situations. So you have irritable short telomere. And low mitochondria. Probably there is a crosstalk between the two, that in fact molecular mechanisms are partially known. And this is a classical trade-off resource fecundity, so it's often interpreted, in fact. But I think that there are other advantages of that that has to be studied experimentally. One is whether it can give rise to kind of mutator phenotype that could facilitate adaptations. And some mitohormesis, because you have this correlation with a low mitochondrial activity. And maybe it's not only detrimental by producing high oxidative stress, but also can be used as a classical ROS signaling. So this really, let's say now, is also the thematic of my team in more, let's say, classical experimental system to address this question. So this is a classical view when you have acute stress during your somatic growth. You have accelerated telomere shortening. So shortening is in common, but they have totally different outcomes. It's really the way I see it. And this leads to senescence aging. And also a prediction of that is that now if you are, let's say maybe like the domestic strain, in a very protective environment, some specialization, you don't have problem to find energy, I would say that your telomeres are under relaxation. That's why you see them growing in the yeast strain. So they are not selected for. So this is an hypothesis we are having now, and we are trying to address also by experimental approach. Anyway, so I want to thank again the work of these two very talented PhD students, Alice on coral, Melania on yeast, and the yeast thing is done in strong collaboration with the team of Genility. We are in the same floor. And nothing would be done without the Tara Foundations and also Tara Pacific Expeditions, and also the crew on the boat, the Centre Scientifique of Monaco, and the INR funding for this project. Thank you.